And come one, come all, as these sisters show you some people that's grinding and standing tall, highlighting the struggle as you're waiting patient just to make it, debating your body aching, you're pacing for it to bubble. We all a village, so it's time to huddle. We gotta come together, empower us through the hustle. Yeah, and together we fall. So I'ma hold my brother and my sister up while we all on the come up. While we all on the come up.
Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Happy New Year.
Merry Christmas, y'all.
Hey, y'all. You are watching on The Come Up. We are live every Sunday at 3 p.m. Pacific Standard Time on MorrisMediaLive.com, where you're watching right now. Shout out to POTUS in the back, always hooking us up. I am Michelle.
I'm Quinny.
I'm Janine.
And again, you are on The Come Up. Here on The Come Up, we highlight individuals who are just blazing trails in their specific industry or field or whatever it is. And we like to talk to them because more than likely they're an inspiration to not only the world, but to us.
Absolutely.
But and today's guest.
Here we go.
Take a drink of water.
Today's guest is us, your beautiful hosts for On The Come Up.
Hey,
you may have noticed that we are dressed in the latest doily fashions because today is our Kwanzaa episode.
Yes.
A lot of African-Americans have been, well, this has become popular in the African-American community as of lately. So we just wanted to honor it. I know I celebrated myself and so does my best friends from time to time. So we just wanted to give you a little history on it and then go into how some of these principles that are included in Kwanzaa are intertwined in our lives and how they help build and maintain our community, culture, and family. So Kwanzaa was started by a guy named, and I may murder his name, I apologize. His name was Maulana Karenga, and he started it. It's an African-American cultural holiday. Not to be confused, it's not religious. It's a cultural holiday. And it's celebrated from December 26th to January the 1st. So tomorrow would be the first day of Kwanzaa.
Yes.
And it's pretty much created to teach and reinforce core African principles and values that can help build and strengthen families, communities, and again, the culture. There are seven core principles known as the Nguzu Saba, which is Swahili, which means seven principles. So we're going to name the seven principles and what they mean. The first principle is Umoja, which means unity. The second principle is Kuji Chakalia, which means self-determination.
I enjoy that
it's
name.
It's so fun to say.
Kuji Chakalia.
Kuji Chakalia. The third principle is Ujima, which is collective work and responsibility.
Sorry about that. I was so engaged, like, that's so good. Like, she really went in. I'm so happy to be here.
Great intro. Great intro, Quinetta. That was very well spoken.
Kwanzaa is near and dear to my heart, and I definitely think it's something that if you don't know about as a African American, that you should research to see if it's something you're interested in. Like, it just
reaffirms
educational
who you are.
And it reaffirms who you are. Definitely.
The fourth principle, Ujima, cooperative economics. Fifth, Nia, purpose.
Yeah, yeah. And the sixth principle is Kuumba.
Yes.
Which is creativity. And the seventh principle is Imani, which is faith.
I love that. I have a cousin named Imani.
Yeah.
Shout out.
So each day has a specific principle. And the last day, which is January 1st, is Imani faith. So Kwanzaa, everybody. Kwanzaa.
Do you guys have any like things that you relate to, like as far as the like which one stands out to you most?
It's hard because I really feel like they all are just such an intricate part of my day-to-day lifestyle. Absolutely. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I feel like all of these principles just help me through every different point in my life and piece of my life. So it's hard to really pick one. I think they
That's
all just
answer.
Go
That's
together.
Answer.
You know what I mean?
I'm going to have to agree with Michelle. What about yourself?
I'm going to have to agree as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, Michelle, I concur. That was a great answer.
I concur.
Yeah.
We're best friends, guys. We agree. But on today's show, we wanted to make it special so you guys can get an opportunity to learn more about us. Yes. And throughout the show, we'll be talking about how the principles relate to us directly. So I'm going to go ahead and throw it over to Miss Janine over here. Cornetta and I will not only be, of course, listening to her and what she has going on, but asking her some questions, as she is one of the most powerful and inspiring women that I know. And I can't wait for you guys to hear
about this. Here we go.
Beautiful human being. Go ahead.
I'm what, dropping off some information about myself?
What happened this past year?
Yeah. 2016 has been quite the doozo. The doozo.
Yeah.
Okay.
Not a doozy, but a doozo.
I feel like a doozo is the female version of doozy.
Doozo would be male.
It's doozo. Masculine.
It sounds masculine.
Yeah. Doozy is like, that's a girl.
Doozy. That's a doozy. Let's see. 2016 has been a doozy, but a blessing nonetheless. Everything has been pretty great, man. You know, just working on life, love, and happiness. Mm. I feel like that's what 2016 has summed up for me so far. Started a new position. I cut my hair again.
Mm-hmm. And it's beautiful.
Which I enjoy. I'm never growing my hair back, ever.
Luckily, you look good.
It was all by chance. It was by chance. Other than that, you know, just trying to keep a smile on my face, man. Happiness, love is in my heart, and I just like to give it to the world.
Can you dive deep more into...
But not dive deep more.
More. Can you further explain? Yes. These words. I am a college graduate. Thank you. Can you further explain your job description as of lately, as far as what you do?
Oh.
And what you would like to do, what you would like to see yourself doing in the future with that?
Oh. I am a visual merchandising manager with a major retail company, like a big box store. So I'm the person that's in charge of product placement on the floor, making sure the mannequins and displays are clean. I make sure the store looks visually appealing for you to want to buy everything in there. Because everybody doesn't like to shop at discount stores. So you like to go into places where they look nice, they look clean, and it's easy to shop. So for people who shop at stores like Topshop or Express or Neiman Marcus, Bloomingdale's, Saks, there are people in that store that set up displays, that dress the mannequins, that clean the windows, that pick out the outfits. And then there are people above them, that something I would like to do, that actually set up those floor displays. Like, they map it out. Like, okay, this is what's happening in the trends for the fall. These are the color stories that you're getting. This is the pattern that might be in place. Flower power, maybe for festival season. Like, you might want to go boho chic. So these are the patterns and the trends that you need to follow in dressing your mannequins and doing your trend runways.
It's beautiful. How would one, if there's anyone who's interested in that type of field, how do you fall into something like that? Because that's something very particular. It's kind of like, oh, yeah, someone does do that job. Yeah. You know what I mean? And it does help you when you go into these stores. It does make you want to buy the product. Mm-hmm. So how does one find their way into that type of career field?
Well, a lot of people go to school. They'll go to FITM for visual merchandising or merchandise management. I kind of fell into it. So, you know, like most people in college or your first job out of high school, you're working retail, you're doing sales as a cashier or whatever. And I got to work an overnight set at a company I was working with, or overnight floor set. And I realized I was pretty good at dressing mannequins and picking color stories, because if the product isn't there and isn't available for you, you have to make those adjustments and you have to make those calls fashion-wise and trend-wise to what goes in the windows or what goes on the floor or what goes on tables or in closets. And I got some recognition from my manager and district manager. I was like, hey, this is something I enjoy. And then there you have it. So throughout the last couple of years, that's what I've been doing, visual merchandising.
But then you also took a little pit stop on it.
I did.
And you went to go teach overseas. And for those who may be new to this season of On the Come Up and aren't privy to the first season, can you just talk a little bit about your...
So one of the a goal of mine was, before I turned 30, I wanted to move out of the country or live out of the country. So, and I knew I wanted to go to Southeast Asia. So Japan, I was like, yeah, I heard it still traces of radiation. That gets an X. China was too many people for me. So I was like, Korea sounds like a good idea. And I knew somebody who taught in Korea already, and he gave me some heat about it and was like, you know, it's a cool country to go to. So for a year and a half, I picked up everything and I moved to Korea by myself. and I taught elementary and middle school students English, and it was a wonderful experience.
Community work.
It taught me so much about myself, to be honest, and I know it sounds corny and it sounds cheesy, but you never realize how strong you are until you are stripped of everything that you were dependent on. Mm. And it took for me to get out there and not know the language, not really be familiar with the food, because Korean food here in America is nothing like Korean food there. To really be stripped of what I thought I would be comfortable in, to really find out who I was and find my own strength. So it was a wonderful and much needed experience, and I hope I get to pass it on to my young ones. In the meantime, I get to pass it on to my nieces and nephews, yeah. Issa, Jordan, Khalil, Amaris, and Micah.
Aww. Hey, y'all.
Beautiful.
So would it be safe to say that technically you're a stylist?
Yeah.
For major.
Yeah, for a major retail store.
Yeah. Do you see yourself hopping into the industry side of styling?
I would love to. I have a bigger passion for men's fashion than I do for women's designs. Mm-hmm. You know, nothing against it, but I just like clean lines, hard structures. I like tailored suits. I like tailored lines, and I enjoy that more so in men's fashion. And especially for artists or people who are coming up, I feel like men's fashion, that really brands who they are as an artist. Mm-hmm. Like, you can see a jacket and be like, oh, that look like something Usher would wear. Mm-hmm. Oh, that look like something Chris Brown would wear. But then there are certain female artists where it doesn't really, it could cross over to so many different people. I enjoy male fashion. It's just cleaner to me.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
So what you're saying is in 2017, you're going to work on styling.
I'll put it on my vision board.
Is it a true passion?
No, it is.
Okay.
I don't want
to make it seem like I'm...
No. It is. But, I mean, I'm going to put it on my vision board. We all know where my heart is, what I feel like I'm destined to do and to be, which is a mommy.
A mommy who styles.
You can do both.
You can definitely do both.
But yeah, I'll definitely put it on my vision board, because I did everything on my vision board beginning of this year, beside I didn't learn how to do my own makeup.
You still got time.
It's 2 weeks. A week left.
I mean, I learned how to put on eyeliner.
Great. Let's start.
That's the hardest part, actually. Because them line to get to be like, be thick over here, little thin line.
You know, my wings look like straight Q-tips. Like smudge lines.
It's stupid.
Hilarious. Hilarious. All right.
So a little bit about me and my world. 2016 yes. was definitely humbling. I give all the glory to God. I was able to be a part of an amazing experience. Not only was I a part of the Lemonade visual album.
Nominated for a Golden Globe.
Which is nominated yes, for a Golden Globe. And side little quick story, we had no clue that we were filming, that what we were filming was going to be that. Mm-hmm. We got a call like, hey, we just, you know, are you available to shoot some Beyonce videos? We like, yeah, cool, all right, whatever. Even while we were there, we was like, okay, what's going on? We weren't able to hear any songs. Mm-hmm. If a song was playing, it was Formation, because it wasn't out yet, but they allowed us to hear it. So we had no clue what it was for, how it was going to be used. And at the moment, we was just like, all right, what is happening? Fast forward, we saw how she pieced it together, and it just blew me away, like, to be a part of something that's going to go down in history. Like, it touched on so many topics that we deal with as Black women, mm-hmm. and even as Black men, and like, musically, it was amazing. So I was able and honored to be a part of that. I also was able to be a part of the Super Bowl, which was another amazing and humbling experience. We rehearsed for an entire month, and we didn't find out until maybe like a week or so before that we were going to be dressed as Black Panthers. So the whole time we thinking, okay, we doing Formation, we hitting all these different formations. You know, it's Beyonce, so we probably gonna have on, you know, something flashy, mm-hmm. some heels or whatever. When it was time to do our fittings, we was like, mind you, it was an all Black girl cast. Black girls rock.
What do you do?
When it was time for the fitting, we were all looking at each other like, yo. Like, once we put the beret on, we was like, are we? Yo, and it just made it that much more honorable to be a part of. So we did the Super Bowl, and then on top of all this amazing greatness and blessings, I was able to, after hard work, dedication, auditioning for about a month, I was able to be a part of the Formation World Tour with Beyonce, which just blew my mind. I was able to travel the country and do what I love, and with a purpose. Nia, one of the principals.
Yes. Hello.
And the Formation World Tour, again, was aligned with Lemonade, and it was just talking about women empowerment and how we should just support each other as a community, and not only as Black people, but whoever you are, be happy in who you are, and stand strong in that and confident in that. Our differences is what brings us together. Like, it kind of bothers me when people say they don't see color. You should see color.
It's beautiful.
Because our differences is what make us beautiful. Mm-hmm. And so it was just amazing to see. And a quick story, when we were overseas, and that double shooting happened with Philandro Castro and I forgot the other name, but the two Black men who got gunned down by police officers. It happened like back to back. I was overseas in Ireland, and when I found out it happened, I just, you know, when it happens in the States, of course, you feel sad, you feel helpless. But to be overseas, multiply that feeling by like 10,000. Like, I just felt so hopeless. And the next day of our show, we found out that Beyonce wanted to, before we did Freedom, which is such a powerful song, before we did Freedom, that she was going to sing a cappella. What we didn't know is that she had all the names of the Black women and men who were gunned down by police brutality. She had all of their names on our 6-foot monolith rotating LED screen. When I tell you, that just took us down, that somebody with that big of a platform is acknowledging that this is a problem and it's not okay. You're recognizing and you're showing the parents of these Black women and men that I see you and I feel you and it's not right and I'm going to say something. It just spoke so much volume. We were all standing on that B stage in that water crying because she sang Freedom a cappella. And she felt it. You know what I'm saying? It's amazing when you have somebody with that big of a platform who still relates to you and still acknowledges what's going on in the community, because she's a part of our community. And that's why I respect her and I love her dearly, because it's like, she not with the shits. Mm-hmm. If she sees something that's wrong, she gonna speak out about it. Like, whether it's through music, whether it's visually, whatever. Like, you know what I'm saying? She sang it a cappella, and right after that, we went back into normal routine, and the song came on, and it was such a release for us, because we were, you know, Freedom, our routine, we're kicking and splashing in water, but we were really getting our anger out and our frustrations and our how sad we were and mad we were, and it was just, it was healing. Mm-hmm. And we didn't realize it till in that moment, and we were all locking eyes with each other like, this is really happening. Like, and it was such a release. So I want to thank her for always just, again, acknowledging what's going on in our communities and just trying to be a voice. Mm-hmm. Using her platform. So I did the Formation World Tour. It was amazing. We just got done in like
yesterday.
Like, oh, yesterday, November? Like November.
Yeah.
And then again, about her just being in the community, we did, her and her husband did a benefit concert while the election was still happening with Hillary, and we were able to perform there, and that was just amazing. Again, you could tell they just are about their family, the community, and the culture, and just uplifting and building us, and it's amazing because they have such a great platform. Mm-hmm. And the fact that they're using it to just spread love and show other people who may only have that outlet of music, like, yo, it's bigger than your neighborhood, it's bigger than the state, it's bigger than the United States. Like, travel the world. So that's what I've been doing. And God is good, man. And I'm just happy. Like, I'm humbled. I can cry right now just talking about all of it, because if anybody know me, y'all know me. My story is, you know, I came from nothing. So to be here is only... it's only God. Mm-hmm. So,
can I ask you a quick question?
Yes.
The three of us have traveled and been in places around the world. Michelle has been to Uganda. Quinetta traveling the world with Beyonce. I've been to Korea. How important for you do you think traveling is for a Black woman?
Traveling for a Black woman or a man is absolutely important, because what happens is you get to see how other cultures live their life. Mm-hmm. And what that does is add to your culture, and it opens your eyes, and you grow. You just experience in the world, and that just adds to your oneness, and then you're able to spread knowledge about what's happening around the world. You never know. You might run into a culture that you feel really connected to. I know for me, I'm really connected to the Caribbean culture. Like, I don't know what it is, but when I hear dance on reggae, they tell you, like, I'm sold.
Fresh off the sands.
Like, I always say, like, if somebody was to take me to Jamaica or one of them islands, it don't even matter. I might not come back because it's just something there. But you have to research and experience that in order to see if the connection is there. So it's just always good because you're learning. You're forever learning. You're forever educating yourself. So traveling is always amazing. Mm-hmm. Always. And then you can just... They give you a piece of their culture, you give them a piece of your culture. You know what I'm saying? Reverting back to the story I was telling, when we were overseas and that happened, there were signs that started to form after she did the freedom moment saying Black Lives Matter. After we did that, after she had that moment of silence for the two men who lost their lives, each show after that, overseas in Europe, who has no idea what's really happening here, they're only getting what's portrayed in media, you saw people with Black Lives Matter posters and saying, we stand with you and we're here for you. And that just meant so much because it's like people are watching and they see it. So it was amazing to see. Again, traveling, spreading your knowledge, learning from them so that we really know what's going on. You know what I'm saying? Because the media, we all know how the media work. Like, they going to give you what they want to give you. But when you go to the source, you get the full story. So it was just, traveling is a must. Even if it's to a different state,
yeah. Get out traveling. There,
you know what I'm saying? So yeah.
You also got engaged, though. So can you talk about that experience
yes,
and how it happened?
I got engaged.
For our viewers and everything.
I got engaged. And if you guys didn't check out season one, my fiance, who was my boyfriend at that time, Britty, he was one of our guests. So
it was a fun episode. Check it out.
Quick story. So once we got the dates for the tour, Janine was like, oh yeah, I think I'm gonna come to the Philly show. I'm like, but we doing Baltimore right after that. She was like, I don't know, I figured out I'm gonna be over there. I'm like, cool, that don't seem irregular. Britton, my boyfriend at the time, was like, oh yeah, I think I'm gonna come to the Philly show. I'm like, okay, cool. He's been to Philly a couple times, so that didn't seem irregular. My mom hit me up like, yeah, Nana want to get everybody together, have a dinner. That's not irregular, because when I come home, the fam get together. Mm-hmm. So June roll around. It's June 5th. So we getting ready, we meeting at the restaurant for dinner. Everybody there, we chit-chatting. Janine walk in, my guy brother was there. He ended up coming. And so we sitting there, we order our food, we chit-chatting. And my nana was like, all right, I want Britton to bless the food. That's not irregular, because Britton,
he's a prayer warrior. Word, dog.
He is a prayer warrior. Like, his prayers will break you down and build you back up.
Yeah.
To who you really supposed to be. So I'm like, all right, cool. So
he gonna pray at my wedding.
I bow my head.
Like, why is Britty? I'm just, look, don't worry about it.
Don't worry about it.
I want everyone to
he
be
got
healed.
Us. He got us. So I bow my head, and Britton praying, he's blessing the food. And then he starts to go into how he's thankful for my family for raising me into such a beautiful woman, and he's thankful for our relationship. Meanwhile, I'm still down here like, yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Meanwhile, this is me like...
Meanwhile, everybody has their cameras out and they're videotaping, and I'm still here with the Lord like, yes, God, yes. So it didn't hit me until he got finished talking, and then he said, so with all that being said, Quinetta Wilmington, and something just clicked, and I looked up like I looked up and I was like, no. He was like, will you marry me? Of course I said yes. Once I got myself together, I told him I was going to punch him in his face because I had no clue. I usually have a little hint to what's going on, you know, just a little fifth sense that women have.
Yeah.
I had no clue. And everybody knew.
Was lying to her for a smooth. Like,
everybody
so
knew.
So long. I was like, ugh.
And I had no clue. So I got engaged and I am now a fiance, soon to be wife. And
how does that feel?
It's amazing. You know, it doesn't feel any different, and a lot of people ask me that all the time, like, do it feel different, like, did y'all do anything different? And it's like, no, because we've been building to this already.
Yeah,
this is just like material for everybody else. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, we've been building to this. Even after we get married, nothing will change because we've already been working towards that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The marriage is just a ceremony to celebrate. So it's still the same. That's still my nigga. Like, I love you, babe. yeah, nothing changed. Like, you just get stronger every day. You learn something new every day. And, you know, he get on my nerves. I get on his nerves. But at the end of the day, I can come to him, like, as a friend on friend mode, like, ew. Or he can come to me as a friend, like, ew. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, I mean, 2016, I'm super excited about what 2017 will bring, not only for me, but for my best friends and for our show and our individual lives. Like, I just had a thought while we were in church. I'm going to just put it out there. Of emailing Black Girls Rock Now, letting them know what we're doing and seeing if we can get a spot to host or even get acknowledged. Hosting is more than enough, but if they want to acknowledge us, cool. But I feel like our energy is needed is to add to the pot. It's
a freshman class of Black Girls Rock.
Already Black Girl Magic Gold Dust everywhere. I feel like we would add another, another sprinkle. So.
Right. Well, Michelle Mitchell.
Michelle.
Shoo.
She like to call her Tanisha.
That's my middle name.
Michelle.
Yeah, man. It's actually been so beautiful just sitting here and like listening to y'all just speak on your paths as I've been fortunate and blessed enough to be, you know, there amongst your trajectory and just seeing everything blossom in front of my eyes. So it's just beautiful actually to just sit and listen to it. I was over here like,
been fighting tears.
Yeah, man, it's so beautiful, and it's like a constant inspiration in so many different ways. You know what I mean? And this year has been humbling as well to me as well. It's just like I've learned a lot about myself as a woman, and it's like, and I've learned about my self determination. It started off. Kind of flowed off of Chirac coming out in December.
If you haven't seen it, please check it out.
My first film, and from that opportunity, I was able to get a manager, one of the top management in the industry, and I was fortunate enough to get managers who, before they even saw Chirac, were like, yeah, we see something in you. So I immediately just started auditioning a lot and getting a lot of no's. And then it's interesting because you're like, okay, I just did this movie, so, you know, it's about to pop, like, yeah, hold on just a little bit and relax, you know. And so with that being said, I still had to, like, push forward as, you know, as I would any other moment or day or what have you. And so I then eventually landed a pilot, and I loved the character and I loved the role, and I had an amazing time shooting it. But unfortunately, the pilot didn't get picked up, and I was just like so heartbroken. Like, my heart was in like itty bitty pieces. I was just like, no, I really love this show. But a great thing that did come out of it was that I fell in love with the king that I'm with now.
And that would be the gentleman who was on a previous episode.
Yeah, so he was a guest star on that show, and, you know, if we didn't have any scenes or anything like that together, but we met in person rather at the rap party, and then, you know, that's a whole nother episode. Maybe a Black Love episode or something. But anyways, then after that, I was kind of like, okay, what am I about to do? How am I going to, you know, make money? How am I going to support myself? It was a really challenging time for me, which is even when Gwyneta was getting engaged, part of the reason why I couldn't make it because I just couldn't afford it. Yeah. I couldn't afford to go. And I was really bummed about it because obviously who wouldn't want to be at one of their best friends when she's getting proposed to? You know what I mean? But it was one of those things where I had to just be like, you know what? God, I trust you. Like, I don't even know, but I just trust you. I moved on faith, on Imani. I moved on Imani that seventh day. I moved into a home situation that kind of just fell into my lap, and it's a beautiful town home that Jeannie is my roommate. And, you know, again, I had moved into the home, but kind of just like, okay, God, I'm trusting, because I felt God being like, move and just trust me. You know what I'm saying? But to be honest with you and transparent, and I'm saying this because I know it can help other people, I just felt it in me that you're going to be okay. And so even after that, of course, it just kept auditioning. And then I got to a point where I was just like, you know what? I'm just going to be me. More than anything, just be yourself. And whatever comes from that, like, it'll be greatness because you're being yourself. Yeah. And so I started to also learn more about how, like, the business side of the industry worked. So I made sure I got a corporation. And my man, Coley, he was very instrumental in that. He literally, one of our dates, he sat me down with his laptop and was like, okay, this is what a C corporation is. This is what a S corporation is. This is how you should do your taxes and things like that, because you're going to be working in the industry. Mm-hmm. And it's important for you to have a loan out company. I didn't even know what that was. I'm thinking, like, oh, okay, they just take all your money and then that's it. I mean, you know, tax man always going to take your money, but to educate, for him to take the time to educate me on that was just so like, oh, wow, yeah, because there are a lot of things that I want to do as an entrepreneur, a lot of businesses I want to own and things like that, of that nature, that I have to be privy to. And so with that, I was able to get an accountant that I really trust and just educating myself on that. And then shortly after that, I went to this audition for, you know, this show that was coming out. And after the audition, I was just like, I really bombed it. Like, I was messing up in the audition. Everyone else, it was for the role that I have now as Detective Bailey, only the weapon. Boop, 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 boop. Everyone else was in there, like, suited and booted, like, looking like a real detective. I was in, like, again, I was in my whole, like, I'm gonna be myself. So I was wearing my faux locks like I have now. I had on, like, my ripped jeans and my baggy shirt. And I walked in, and, like, LaToya Luckett was sitting there, and she was all suited, and she had, like, a nice little popping red lip, and she was all pretty. Like, everybody's in there was, like, suited and booted. I'm in, like, my Tim boot heels and my baggy jeans. And I was just like, okay. So then afterwards, I was like, yo, man, I bombed it. But I was just like, all right, whatever. Next thing I know, an hour later, my manager's like, yo, they want you to come to Warner Brother, like, by 5. Like, can you make it for a callback? And I was like, oh, okay. I get to Warner Brothers. It's like myself and maybe 4 or 5 other black girls. Again, everybody else suited and booted. I'm like, well, I made it this far. Might as well stay. But I'm like looking at these lines like, okay, I'm like, I have to get this stuff, because it was like 4 different scenes. And each scene was like at least 2 pages. Like, it was so much. You know what I mean? I was the last one to go into the room. Again, I'm on my whole, just my vibe, and I do my thing. And then the showrunner, Matt Miller, the creator of Lethal Weapon, the TV show, was just like, he looked at me. He was like, so tell me about yourself. Like, where did you come from? Like, who are you? So I just was like, I'm Michelle. Used to be a professional dancer. And, you know, I just finished working with Spike Lee. And, you know, here I am. And then the other executive producer was like, so have you ever worked with Fatima Robinson? I was like, yes. She kept me employed for quite some bit as a dancer. And they were like, okay, cool. And then fast forward to the end of that week, I was going to an audition for some Netflix show where I couldn't have any makeup on or nothing like that. So I'm like, cool, I don't have to wear no makeup. I'm about to be in my little workout gear. I'm on my way to that audition. They're like, Lethal Weapon wants you to come back to Warner Brother again to test for the network now. And I'm like, so that means, but they're like, they want you to come in like a detective though. Like, now you got to be a little bit more slick. Like, you need makeup on, you need to look suited and booted. Mind you, I still have my faux locks in. So I run to the Netflix audition. I do that. Then I run to the mall on Hollywood Boulevard. I grab clothes. I didn't have any makeup with me. So I had to go to Sephora and like get makeup. I went to my manager's office. She's helping me like pin my little faux locks back to make it look neat. I run to Warner Brothers. It's like 4. I have to be there at 5. It's like 4:45. I'm trying to make my way there. There's traffic. Like, I'm sweating. I'm just like, oh my God, I hadn't looked at the scenes since that Monday, because like, you know, you do your auditions and you keep it moving. You're just like, whatever. I get to the Warner Brothers. I'm just trying to like relax. You know what I mean? It's only me. Ain't nobody else there. I'm like, what is going on? So for my actors out there, y'all know the pressures of when you test for a show. Like, testing for a show is pretty much like the network is now looking at you to see, you know, whoever's running the show or producers are like, we really like this individual. But then the testing is like for the network to see if you are a good fit and this, that, and the third and whatever. So I tested, and I was just, you know, I left it in the room, and I left just kind of like, I don't know. It was one of those things where, you know how like you'd be like, yo, I killed that joint, like, I was cool. I didn't feel like that, but I didn't feel horrible either. I just was like, I don't know. It was just a long, crazy day. And the following day, I found out that I had booked the job. And so then after that, I was like, dang, now I really got to take these faux locks out though. So Janine helped me like take them out.
It was like a whole thing.
We was like, oh, like my hair was actually really locking, which I gotta be careful with these now. The curls, man, they don't play with the faux locks. And I started literally like that Monday, I wanna say, because we had our table read, and then we just moved forward from there. And it was something where it was a character that just was reoccurring. They didn't really know. And it was just every week I didn't know if I was going to be on the next episode or not. And it was always just like this a tad bit of anxiety. Like, I don't know. But I just kept being like, just be yourself. Do your thing. And sure enough, then they offered me, which I don't think I've told you guys yet. I'm officially a series regular. Yay! Woo! I can let that loose.
Yo, congrats,
I was holding it in my throat for so long. So I'm officially a series regular on Lethal Weapon. So I'm really excited about it.
Yo, congratulations.
Thanks.
I cry when I get excited.
So it's just all of that to say it's been a journey, man. It's been definitely a journey. What I'm most excited about is by the time this airs, I will be in Uganda, back in Uganda again, teaching the kids out there. And Quinetta has a similar experience. When you teach just youth in general, or even with Janine, teaching youth, it just does something in your spirit. That's why I relate to you so much, Janine, when you say, like, I know a part of my purpose is being a mom, because there's something about children and their innocence and their curiosity and their creativity and being over there in the motherland is just an incredible experience, and it's an initiative that I am going to continue to do yearly. So I'm super excited about that. Just to, it keeps me grounded amongst all of this, you know, Hollywood stuff, as I know and I'm confident that, you know, I'll do more film.
I'm on the brink of breaking down, though.
I'm confident that I'll do a lot of films and a lot of amazing things in my career. But knowing that I'm going to be going here every year to Uganda, knowing that I have this show, like these other things that keep me grounded, creative and grounded, I'm so grateful for. So 2016, thank you so much for just humbling me and teaching me and helping me realize, like, how incredible I am and how I can say that. You know what I mean?
Amazing. I have a quick question because you didn't mention it, but Spike Lee also put you down with NBA 2K.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, what? Which was also like a movie within the video game. Can you explain some of that and how you had to go about it as far as like the little things on your head and motion sensors and all of that?
Yes. So before I did Chirac, I got casted in Spike Lee's NBA 2K16. And so...
She's CC.
Yeah, I'm CC. What's up, y'all? And even that audition process was another testimony. We'll get into that another episode. But anyways, so that was, it was a video game. And so what it was every day we had to suit up in these, I forget what they were called. Just like
motions?
Yeah. It's motion caption. So you're in these suits and you have like these dots on you that pretty much they... Well, oh, I thought you said something. they capture all of your body movement. Mm. So everything that you're doing from what's going on with your... There was like a camera too attached to the helmet that was in your face. So you would have to act in front of people with this camera just in your face. Like, and it would be a small little light because they're digitally, they're getting all of like your muscle movements and all the idiosyncrasies and the little things that we do or whatever you were bringing to your character. Everything was so that it was censored so that they can capture all of that. It was a crazy, incredible experience. We were up there for 3 weeks. Every day we started at 6 a.m. We were in a boonie somewhere up in Northern California, but it was beautiful. And Spike, really, the incredible thing about him is he really is about new, young talent. Mm-hmm. And that's something that is, you can see throughout the trajectory of his career, he's always been like that with Denzel and Wesley Snipes and Kerry Washington and Angela Bassett. Like, he started a lot of their career. Samuel Jackson, I mean, the list goes on and on and on. So I'm very grateful for him because he did pretty much introduce me to the industry on a bigger platform. So had it not been for him just taking a chance, because, you know, I went to the audition with no real acting experience professionally anyway, and he took a chance on me, and that just open the floodgates to so many other opportunities, and I feel a good reason of why I'm on Lethal Weapon now. Nice. Shout out to Spike Lee, man. Yeah. I appreciate you. He's the most giving, loving person ever. Man. Like, he's super cool.
So that's us in a nutshell. We can be here for hours. The stories go on and on.
Yeah, so are we getting into
a little wine,
A little wine?
A little naughty or nice situation?
Y'all, you know, I'm not drinking till the new year, but...
I give it a swirl.
A little swirl. Well, so, Janine, tell us about your little holiday wine.
A holiday wine that I learned from a dear friend of mine that I met in Korea, Lejean, who I love dearly.
Hey, Lejean!
Who was the little spice in my life. Something called mulled wine. M-O-U-L-D. I don't know if I make it exactly like the way she did, but so you warm up the wine. You don't boil it because you want to boil the alcohol out of it. I said boil correctly, too.
Boil.
You boil the wine. You add cinnamon, nutmeg, allspice. You can add like some squeezes of lemon.
It's so good.
A lemon. You can put some mandarin oranges in it or fresh orange slices in it. Let it bring it to a nice little simmer. Again, do not bring it to a boil. Add some cranberries to it just with some cute little accessories, and then you enjoy. It's a wonderful holiday drink, and I would encourage everybody to incorporate it into your holiday festivities.
More wine.
More wine.
But it's like hot wine. So
yeah. So imagine a wine version of a hot toddy almost.
Mm. Ooh, I actually enjoy hot toddies.
It's delicious. I'm going to drink mine.
So... We are running a little on time.
Maybe let's just jump into. We had some things planned. Maybe we should just go ahead and jump into maybe our group laughs. What y'all thinking? Or our gift? What do you think?
Our gift,
group laugh, and gift.
I think
it's our show. We can do what we want.
That's true. This is true.
What do we want to do? Janine, it's on you.
Let's bring it up a little bit. We've got deep. We're talking about our journeys.
Yeah.
Let's do a group laugh. Who want to explain the group laughs?
Go ahead.
So we all like to laugh. Everybody likes to laugh, but laughing is much funnier in groups. So we each picked a video. We have this video and we're going to show it to see if we get some group laughs out of it. I've seen one or two of this girl's videos on social media. I think she's funny. I haven't seen this one though.
So this is your video,
this
right?
This is the video that I provided. I thought it was super funny. So
let's see if she gets her group laugh.
They think it's funny and we have a nice group laugh.
Let's see. Mm-hmm. Let's see. Oh, Slavon?
Yes?
Do you have any idea how much a polar bear weighs?
No.
Enough to break the ice. Hi, I'm Helen.
Slavon? Yes?
Are you a beaver?
Why?
Because damn!
Yes.
Do you like mangoes?
Yes.
Oh, good, because I'm also wet, juicy, and there needs to be something hard in me. Still.
Yes.
Is it raining here?
No.
Only because it seemed to be dripping on your foot.
Oh, Christ.
Slave up.
What?
Do you work at Little Caesars?
No.
Because you're hot and I'm ready. Do you like physics?
Mine!
Because I want you to calculate how fast these panties will be dropping!
Well, come on!
I'm on you.
What?
Are you a sea lion?
No.
I can see a lion on my bed! Ah! Steven.
What?
Are you from Japan?
No.
Because I want to get in Japan. Oh, Steven?
Yes?
Wow. You get a group laugh.
That break the ice
funny.
One.
Oh
that was my
funny.
God, that's a strong group laugh.
That's funny. That's really funny.
So yeah,
that's a good one. Okay. You know what? I'm gonna actually save mine for another show just because we're running out of time. That was a good one. That was really funny.
Yes.
She said, Steven.
How much does the polar bear weigh?
Are you from Japan? Because I want to Japan.
I want to get into Japan.
All right, who wants to introduce this?
Nice. Our next thing is, being that it is a holiday season, of course, we are all fortunate enough to... do we want to do our videos? Do we want to do... Let's do our gift. Okay. Sorry, y'all. We have so many things planned, but everything is just moving, so we appreciate y'all being so patient. Our next thing, though, so I will introduce this. I'm really excited. So one thing to know about all of us is that we love black men.
Mm.
That is one thing, if you don't take anything away from from this show, we love black men and we feel that they are extraordinary creatures that
Absolutely.
Walk this earth. And I feel that I've been fortunate enough, all of us actually have been fortunate enough to have so many incredible black men in our lives. Our fathers have raised us to the incredible women that we are, as well as our significant others, brothers, the list just goes on and on and on and on. But unfortunately, the world, we feel, doesn't give them as much love as they deserve.
Yeah.
So us, with along with some fellow queens, we put together a video just to show our love and appreciation for our brothers out there. If you're listening, if you're watching, please know that you are loved. Please know that you are appreciated. Please know that we have your back, and know that you are the rock to this world. Okay. You hear me? Okay. To this world.
King.
So enjoy this gift from us to you. We hope you like it. And
should we do our sign-offs and end with that, or...
I want to come back and
come back.
And just come back and give some love.
Right. Give some love. We'll be crying when you come back. So check it out.
Teacher, Mr. Smith.
My papa was my father.
Me and my dad are very tight.
Oh, my father.
My father.
It would be my daddy and my stepdaddy. My father.
He was just so intelligent and so poised and so smart.
So yes, my papa, rest in peace.
Outside of any indiscretions, he never allowed anything to happen outside of his private life to affect how he treated me as his daughter.
Low cut, bald, or locks?
I'll take it either way.
Low cut.
I'm gonna go with Caesar.
Low cut.
I like it all, but my favorite is locks.
Traditionally, locks, and lately, low cut. I've also done a little bald, too.
Suited and booted or jeans and Tim's?
I like to combine the two.
I say Tim's and jeans.
Jeans and Tim's all the way, but you have to know how to get suited and booted.
I can get him suited in some Tim's. We got ourselves a winner.
Like a baggy pant, but also like you can clean it up. You can go catch a good time with a little two-step and keep
suited and booted.
Tim's and jeans, sneakerhead, that's my kind.
Just that common stereotype from, I feel, other cultures that think that all black men are extremely aggressive.
They don't take care of their families.
Weak.
Buggish.
Always cheating on his women.
Angry that they're thugs.
Those are like the obvious ones.
Tall or short. I'm 5'11". It don't matter.
Don't need to talk to me. I'm 6 foot.
Tall, please.
Sorry.
Traditionally tall, but lately I've gotten a little lax on my standards, so.
I'm gonna have to go with tall for this one. No offense, hello all my brothers.
I'm 5'11 and a half. So, preferably tall.
Do I think a black man can love a black woman and still date outside of his race? Wow, that's a loaded question.
This is a touchy question.
I would hope so because they mama black. I would hope so.
At the end of the day, I feel like the support is shown through action and not necessarily who you choose to enter into a relationship with. So I feel like it's possible for a brother to date outside of the race and still, you know, hold his sisters down.
If I were the mother of a black man and if he brought home a woman, and I'll just say a white woman, for me, I would feel as though somewhere along the line I failed to show him the beauty in a black woman. I feel like the only person that can mirror me and understand my child would be a black woman.
I would hope dates that individual for the right reasons of like love, respect, honor, and admiration.
I think the man who truly, truly loves the black woman, no matter who they date outside their race, they will always come back to the black woman.
Absolutely. Yes, but then it's still like, okay, you love me,
but you don't want to be with me, so what's the issue?
It's hard to believe that you fully do love black women when you basically skipped over all these amazing black women to choose something else, especially when there's so many phenomenal black women that are single who want specifically black men and date exclusively black men.
Find me.
I would say no.
Well, my brother's out there, y'all dating outside your races. It's all good with me, just as long as you respect the black women and still have our back when it's time to have our backs. Woo, my favorite feature.
They have to keep it cleaner.
All of this up in here. Shoulders, like broad shoulders.
Outside of the, you know, that wood.
Beard. That is my favorite feature on a man. I don't care how fine you are, if them teeth not straight or that smile don't get me, it ain't nothing else we can talk about. They're definitely arms. Lips. I like lips. I got big lips, so I like nice.
Three words to describe a black man:
resilient,
a man,
the standard,
unique,
strong,
strength,
magnetic,
warm-hearted,
brilliant,
protector,
resilient,
sexy,
fearless,
king,
foundation,
educated,
free,
solidarity, empathetic,
powerful, just incredible,
like a sleeping giant. They have yet to realize their full potential.
Black men have a very specific and particular way of carrying themselves in the world. The way that they lead in the world is unique and special. Black men have a strength, an endurance that I don't really see in other men. And I think that's primarily what makes them special.
Every time I watch that thing.
Black men, we salute
we
you.
We love y'all, man. We love salute y'all, you. Man. Definitely. Shout out to the fellas of the Hippie Hangout. They did a Queen video.
It was amazing.
Speaking of Who Is She, which inspired us to do this response video. So if you have the opportunity, please check out their video. And hopefully, maybe they're watching. Maybe they'll respond to us. And so, yeah, with that, we're going to go ahead and close out this show. Thank you for tuning in to this special Kwanzaa episode featuring yours truly. We will not be on the air on New Year's Day, but we'll be right back that following Sunday giving you all of the amazing individuals who are inspiring this world and who are on the come up. Before we close out, we have a 2017. Each of us are going to give you, I guess, our mantra, if you will, or our motto for 2017. And I would say, fuck fear.
Woo!
Yeah.
This has been rolling with me for a few years now, so I'm not changing it. You just mature into it as you grow. Trust the process.
I'm a stick to one that I've come to learn and live by, and I have it tattooed on me. Live, laugh, and love.
Absolutely. That fear thing, I always think of that whenever I'm shaking
Fuck
in my boots. I'm like, girl, just go for it.
Because it's all in your mind.
And for those of you who are celebrating Kwanzaa along with us, just research it. Like Quinetta said, it's a beautiful way to just appreciate life. Not only just being African American, but just life. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I think it's a great initiative, and it's definitely something I plan to pass on to my children. Right, definitely gonna pass it down. Again, I'm Michelle Michener. You can follow me at Michelle, M-I-T-C-H-E-N-O-R, Michener.
I'm Quinny, and my handle is Quinny from Philly, Q-U-I-N-N-Y-F-R-M-P-H-I-L-L-Y.
Janine Holcomb, you can find me on Instagram at @moments_matter, because they do.
I love her.
I love that.
I love her.
You should like, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. Just do something.
We got to cut.
And make sure you follow our show at On The Come Up BGR on all social media platforms. If you know someone that you feel is an inspiration to this world, or if you are an inspiration to this world, go ahead and email us at onthecomeupbgr@gmail.com. We are taking submissions. We'll also be taking sponsorships and advertisement opportunities for those out there who have a clothing brand, who have businesses or what have you. Again, email onthecomeupbgr@gmail.com. We would love to hear from you.
Yes.
And on that note,
Happy New Year, everybody.
Happy New Year. See you in 2017.
Happy Kwanzaa. Wow. You are Happy on
Kwanzaa. The Come Up.
Oh, emotional.
Sexy.